I hope you guys were blessed by that first session. We kicked off the conference talking about genuine faith, talking about real faith, specifically with the theme of correspondence. What is real faith? What does faith look like? What are the components of a Christian's faith? I found it to be very, very helpful. But before we dive into that and before we talk about the topic of the conference at large, I wanted to hear a little bit more about Matt. I've heard a little bit about your life. I've heard a little bit about kind of how you came to be a Christian, how you came to be a pastor. I wanted to ask you to share your testimony. How did the Lord save you? A little bit about your background. How did you, what was the context of, you know, your upbringing, and how did you end up in the ministry at such a young age?
There's
a lot there.
Yeah, there's a lot there. So
you have 2 minutes.
2 minutes. So the Spirit regenerated my heart, and I believed the gospel and was saved. I believe I was saved by the grace of God. I believe the Spirit of God regenerated my heart and brought me to repentance and faith. And that's sort of the theological answer to that. But the sort of practical, personal, social, familial answer to that goes a little something like this. I was born in Los Angeles in the 70s. I was born into a family. My dad was a pastor. Imagine that. And my dad and my mom were in the inner city. I hail from Inglewood. Have you heard of the place, Inglewood? Inglewood? I'm from Inglewood. My dad pastored a church in the inner city. Long story short, my parents' marriage fell apart. I was a little boy, and we literally lived in the church. So the church had a living quarters on top, so we would literally walk downstairs to go to church. My bedroom was on top of the church building. So that's all that we knew. As a kid growing up in the inner city, it was a bad neighborhood. We didn't go outside much. There was, you know, guns and all kinds of great stuff back in LA in that era. So we just lived in the church. We're little church mice, my brother and I. At night, we would play hide and go seek in the sanctuary. I thought the Holy Ghost was really a ghost, by the way. And then one morning before church, my dad sat us down and said, "I need to talk to you boys before church starts." And I thought, oh man, we're in trouble. Usually when he wants to talk to us, we're in trouble. He said, "Your mom and I are getting divorced, and we're going to tell the church today, so we thought we'd let you know first." Gee, thanks, Dad. You know, like, we're about to walk downstairs, and you're going to drop that bomb, and I'm 8, and man, that was wild. And my mom left. Long story short, didn't know it at the time, but there was an affair that was going on. My dad didn't know it at the time either. My dad took custody of my brother and I. I was 8 years old. After going to school and getting a seminary degree, you know, there's really only one thing you could do with a seminary degree is be a pastor. But after your marriage is falling apart, that's not going to work out. So my dad went and became a cop in the city, and went back to school and became a cop. And so we lost everything. When you're 8 years old, your bedroom's everything, right? So all I know is my parents got divorced and I lost my bedroom. I was mad at God. I was mad at the church. I was mad at my parents, their relationship and what it was like in their home. Lots of fighting, yelling. So what I saw in the pulpit and what I saw in the living room, you know, there was a disconnect there. And I was really confused as a little kid. If you would have asked me, like, is Jesus God or whatever, I would have said, yeah, that was like what I knew. I believed in Jesus as a kid, but I was mad at the church. I was mad at the hypocrisy of my parents. My father, though, a simple guy from the South, we go to church on Sundays. So when he left the church, he found another church that was down the way in the same denomination to go to. And as a single parent dad, he took my brother and I, and he hung out in the back pew on this side and just laid low with my brother and I to sort of start life over. So that was our life. And I rebelled like crazy as a teenager. There's lots of long story shorts in this, but it was L.A. I managed to to get involved in the record industry. Back in the day, we were into breakdancing and doing all kind of stuff, and there was an A&R for a big record label that picked us up. And so when I was a little kid and my dad was gone, I was a latchkey kid, I'm a Gen Xer, we actually, in my teenage years, I got exposed to a lot of stuff through being in LA and music industry. So drugs, alcohol, all that scene entered my life. I was conflicted the whole time because I really believed Jesus was God. I had a lot of confusion with regard to that transformation thing I talked about tonight, because I just hadn't seen that. The Christians I knew in my dad's church where we were, there was a lot of duplicity. And then the new church that we came to, it was a small church, there was like 40 people in it, and it seemed like no one wanted to be there. I mean, it was just a miserable little place. I remember one Sunday, one of the ushers grabbed me by the ear and cussed me out because I brought a drink into the sanctuary. You know, I was like, dang, dude, you wash your mouth out with soap, big guy. So my church experience was just weird, you know? It was just weird, and my parents and all of it. But I still, like, I would be the teenager who was, like, high as a kite, smoking weed, living the L.A. scene, talking about Jesus is the only way to heaven. You know, like, it was just weird. So, long story short again, fast forward, a guy who I respected, who was actually listening to some music I had produced, and he started witnessing to me about Jesus. And I told him, man, leave me alone. I believe in Jesus. You know, Kanye West, Jesus walks. You know, we're cool. yeah, Jesus, of course, you know. And he looked at me. He had headphones on. He was listening to my music when he said it. He pulled the headphones down. He goes, if you believe in Jesus, why are you talking about this? He's like, don't get me wrong, it's dope and all, but why are you talking about this if you really believe in Jesus? You claim you believe in Jesus, but your life doesn't look like it. And I mean, where I'm from, that'll get you punched in the mouth. So I thought, I want to punch him in the mouth. But I thought, you know what? He's right. He like daggered me in my heart. And it was a setup. It was a total setup. His name is Patrick Short. Blessed be the name of Patrick Short to the ends of the earth. Patrick Short invited me to church. I told him I go to church with my dad on Sundays. I can't do that. He was priming the pump. They were doing an evangelistic outreach at his church. And so he's like, I'm in this play at my church. Like, come and support me. You know, we're friends. I was like, all right, man, whatever. It's important to you. I'll roll through. So I rolled through this little play that this guy I know is in. And they were doing skits about people dying and going to heaven or hell and judgment or whatever in this play. And a preacher got up at the end and just preached the gospel. And I was inside, like my soul was just getting ripped apart various different ways. And as I was watching it, I was thinking like, I believe this. Like, I believe in heaven and hell, and I believe in Jesus. I believe, you know, the Bible or, you know, like I believe this stuff. And then the preacher went into this, like, good tree, good fruit, like if you really believe it and your life's not showing it. And he just preached repentance. I had been in two churches my whole life. Both of them had less than 50 people in them. I had never heard the gospel, like an invitation to repent quite like that before. You know, we as a kid in my dad's church and the other church, we'd say the sinner's prayer. My grandma, you know, my parents would send me over to my grandma's house. God bless Grandma Neva. She lives in Oregon. Shout outs to Grandma Neva. She would lead me through the sinner's prayer like every time I went over. Give me a chick track and make me say the prayer, you know, and I'd say it over like, did I do it right? You know, so I'm at this church and they just preached the gospel and repentance and told people to come forward. I'd never seen anything like it. And next thing I knew, I was on the stage. It was surreal. Like, I walked forward. And I literally was on my knees on the stage crying like a schoolgirl. No offense to the schoolgirls in the house, but I was crying, and I said the prayer, and it was different this time. And there I was, in this church in the South Bay, and my life was changed. And I went home, and I threw away everything. I got rid of everything. I cut off everything, and I never went back. And that was like 23 years ago. Never went back. Never went back. I was, as they would say, on fire. I couldn't get enough. I wanted to learn more. I wanted to have more transformation. Those years of just being duplicitous and living in the LA scene and doing all that, and I didn't want anything to do with it. Like it was like there was no going back. There was no going back. Patrick Short, because he boldly confronted me and invited me, and whoever that dude was who preached the gospel that night, it was crazy. So like, 5 years later, I went back to the church because they were doing the play again. I was like, I need to go see that thing again. You know, that thing changed my life. Sitting there watching it like, this play is stupid. But God used it. So that little church that my dad would drag us to, you know, because I was 19, 20. I lived at home until I got married. My dad's rule in the house was you come to church on Sunday. You go to school. You come to church on Sunday, you know, and, you know, he didn't know what was going on. I mean, I'm sitting in my bedroom smoking weed, and my dad had no idea. He just, you know, other stuff's going on. So my life changed. I'm going to church with my dad, and some of the older people in the church were like, my dad's name's Herman. It's funny. So people at church are going, hey, Herm's son is all fired up, you know, because I used to sit in the back on this side. And I would act like I was praying, but I was hungover, passed out, you know, just feeling horrible. And now I'm in church like, all right, let's do this, you know, all 40 of us, yeah, you know. And they had something called Layman Sunday in this church, where they would pick a layman to run the service that Sunday. And so this is the dumbest idea ever, but... So they said, Herm's kid is on fire. Have him do the church service. So I'm like 21. They had me do the church service. I invited all of my friends to come to church. The church of 40 turned into a church of 400 that Sunday because all my friends wanted to know, why did Matt stop smoking weed and hanging out and making music? And they all came to church, and I preached the gospel, and I did what was modeled to me. The people who were discipling me at that time. We did an altar call. People said the prayer and came to Jesus, and then the church was like, I guess we got to do something with all these people who came forward. It's about 40 people came forward. So they asked me, would you do a weekly Bible study? And they gave me some Billy Graham materials or whatever to follow up with them. So I don't know what I'm doing. I'm brand new in this thing. And next thing I know, I'm preaching on a Sunday morning and leading a Bible study. Again, don't do that in your churches. Long story short, that church of the 40 people that my dad drugged me to when I was 8 years old and I hated it to death and wanted nothing to do with it, but my dad made me go, that's the church I've been pastoring for the last 20 years. And I always look off to this side when I'm preaching because I just keep pinching myself in the providence of God that he saw fit to take a sinner as jaded and confused and lost and to raise us up to do that. And in the midst of that, the Lord brought a handful of us neighborhood kids back. One of my right-hand men on staff who's been there the whole time, we used to smoke weed together. We used to smoke weed in strobe lights and run at each other. We did the dumbest things, and we're both like in ministry, and we just go, what is this? God uses the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. Now, that said, as soon as I came on staff, I ended Layman Sunday, and we don't put fools in pulpits, but that's how God did it. He graciously grabbed a hold of me. He used people who weren't threatened by whatever coolness I had at the time. I used to have hair. And who just were like, whatever, I don't care who you are, Matt. Like, you're a hypocrite. Come to my church play. The dumb church play changed my life. And it had nothing to do with the play. It had everything to do with the grace of God. I never wanted to be a pastor because of my upbringing. I'd never seen, you know, I don't want anything to do with that. Being a pastor, are you kidding me? Why would I want to do that? And so by the grace of God, that's what it is.
That's awesome. Praise the Lord for that. Yeah. So I've heard your testimony before. I know you've shared it with me, but even listening to it now, I see just how this question of real faith, of genuine faith, you've really seen kind of a stark contrast between the two, both in yourself and in the people around you. You know, you've seen examples of what would kind of push you away from Christianity because in your understanding, well, that's not real. That's not a representation of what these things we're hearing from the pulpit. If you could give us really a definition, like a functional definition of what is genuine faith, what is genuine Christianity, based on both what you see as a pastor and what God has done in your life and in your heart, how would you define that?
I mean, genuine Christianity is Christ, so it's living and believing Christ. So I'll flesh that out in the sessions tomorrow. I'm going to try and touch on it in various realms of family, friendship, church, you know, work. There's all these realms that we are in, but it's living as unto Christ in all those. Christ is real in terms of objective reality, and he's real, as we would colloquially say, like he's the real deal. It's genuine repentance and faith in Christ. We will never be real. Let he who says he's without sin, right? He's a liar. We will never be fully real until we are glorified. So there's always going to be this tear as you're being sanctified. Sin is fake, and we all sin, so we're always going to be wrestling with being phony and fake and not real. So there's always, there's that, and we got to wrestle with that. So real faith is walking in repentance and faith after the triune God in all realms of life. That's what I'd say.
That's great. Thank you. So if we can kind of zone in on specifically what you talked about tonight, this question of correspondence, you gave us the subpoints, and we walked through the different aspects that make up real faith, that make up that genuine faith. You said this thing, you said truth is that which corresponds with reality. Now, you briefly touched on the fact that we live in a culture where people will say things like, well, this is my truth, as opposed to just truth that applies to everyone. What happens when that reality that truth is supposed to correspond with seems to be at odds, or it seems to kind of change with the culture from what the Bible would say? What do we as young people do when we come in contact with the culture saying, well, that's not actually reality?
We critically engage it. So we have to take truth claims on their merits. So if someone says this isn't true, then we would say, well, why should I believe that that's not true? What sort of evidence do you have? It's worth noting, as Christians, we're not the ones who are always on the hot seat, by the way, you know. So it's appropriate to say, prove to me God doesn't exist. You know, we're always the ones, prove to me God exists. Prove to me he doesn't exist. We put their claims on the hot seat, too. What sort of evidence do you have for believing that truth is relative, say? Because I can give you some reasons why truth isn't relative, pointing out that the statement itself can't even get started because it contradicts itself, using my married bachelor, square circle, two-horn unicorn illustration. You're making an objective claim that truth is relative. Which one is it? It's incoherent. So I just press into the statements. They say, well, you know, the culture changes or whatever. Okay, fine. Some cultures love their neighbors, some cultures eat their neighbors. Which culture do you want to live in, right? You want to go cannibalist, or you want to go vegan? I mean, what? Like, cultures change. Truth doesn't, though, so don't you want to be grounded in something that doesn't change over time? I mean, are you using, you know, we're in America here, right? If you said, we're talking about slavery or something, like the transatlantic slave trade, and I tried to justify slavery on the basis of the culture at the time thought that it was fine to just rape and enslave African Americans. I mean, who are you to judge? That was the culture. He'll go, what? You know, so like turn it on the one who's making the claim. If it's the case that, you know, things change over time, then we can't say slavery was wrong. We can't say the Holocaust was wrong. We have feet firmly planted in thin air. There's, you know, you can't say anything is wrong. You can't even get started with this stuff, you know. And so with that, you know, you make a statement that something's wrong, and people will say things like, you know, who are you to judge? You know, and I go, so you think it's wrong to judge? Yeah. So when you're saying who are you to judge, you're judging me for making a judgment. You don't see that? I mean, if it's wrong to judge, why are you judging me for judging, right? Like, so I think those claims are just incoherent, and you got to press back and say, what evidence do you have for it, and put them on the hot seat. If all truth is relative, I mean, prove it. Give me something objective to why I don't believe it's relative. And if you prove it, you just show you're wrong. So, you know, cultures come and go, and people need to see that. And one of the things that you can do too, my doctoral mentor taught me this one. It's great. Dr. J.P. Moreland, he says, when you find someone who's doing the relativist thing, take something that they care about and relativize it. And so he had this great exchange with another professor. They were doing some outreach thing at one of the UCs, and this other philosophy professor sort of challenged him, and he knew that professor was an environmentalist. And so in response to this objection that was made, he goes, anecdotally, I have a story to tell. And he's like, last weekend, my friends and I, you know, we got a whole bunch of of battery acid and waste, and we went out on a boat, and we just wagered, like, how many fish would bubble to the surface as we poured this stuff out, you know? And so we're pouring all this stuff in the ocean, you know, and, oh, man, by golly, you know, old Bill, he won, you know, 40 fish bobbled up to the top, you know? And the professor's face is like, you know, he goes, do you think that's objectively wrong, you know? So if you take something that they care about and you relativize it, you'll find, like, they're closet objectivists. Like, everyone is. It's just intuitive. So I would say you just turn it on them and, you know, play advocate.
Yeah, that's really helpful. So to go a little bit deeper with that question, so, like, that's how you would engage with the culture. What happens when we encounter something in the scriptures that seems to not really align with what the world would say can actually happen? Maybe some of these Old Testament narratives that are difficult. Maybe some of these things, that some of these claims, these truth claims that we read in the Word of God that people would say, well, that can't be real. That can't be true. A man can't live inside of a fish.
Yeah, you know, you press back on it and say, so what is your evidence for this? So, if we're talking about Jonah, you know, what is your evidence for this? So typically what I would do, like in the case of Jonah, the person who makes an objection like God can't cause a man to survive inside of a fish. Typically there's a presupposition that's driving the claim that has nothing to do with marine biology, okay? And it has everything to do with a theological presupposition. So I'll say, I'm happy to address the issue of marine biology, but first, if I may, ask a clarifying question. Do you believe in the existence of God? Because it seems to me, if there is a God who can make the world out of nothing, right, like you look at the complexity of the cosmos and cosmological constants, if there's a God who can make the world out of nothing, I just don't find it unreasonable to think that he could cause a man to survive in some underwater creature, given that he could make the world out of nothing. A being that has the power to create the cosmos ex nihilo, I don't think if he's like, man, I want to make a guy survive underwater for a couple days, I can't do it. So I want to back off of the statement and ask about the presupposition, because presuppositions drive these things. So it's always like, so what's behind that? And typically, with regard to Jonah and some other things like miracles, say, miracles inside of Scripture, the 10 plagues or whatever, that's just crazy. And I go, okay, so, like, do you believe in God? Well, no. Okay, well then let's talk about God and not miracles, because it makes no sense to talk about the plausibility of miracles if there is no God. I'm with you. If there is no God, the Jonah thing's dumb. And I'm with you. It sounds crazy. So let's talk about the reasons we have for the existence of God. And then we'll go into, I presented quickly tonight, the cosmological argument, everything that has beginning has cause, the universe had a beginning, so the universe had a cause, law of cause and effect. And then I'll just start mounting a cumulative case for the existence of God. And then I'll say, okay, so if there's a God who does that, is it reasonable that he can't cause something to survive within a creature for a couple of days? I just don't find that unreasonable. And if they say, I still do, then I would ask, on what basis? On what basis that is the case? Now, with regard to exegesis, though, and the claim of having a problem with Jonah surviving in some sort of sea creature, we're not sure exactly what kind, the Hebrew is ambiguous there, it is worthy noting with regard to the exegesis of Jonah, there many scholars think that Jonah didn't survive, he died, he was dead, and that he was spit up and brought back to life. In other words, it's a Lazarus story. He died, and you look at his prayer on the, I don't have time to exegete Jonah, but you look at his prayer about the depths of Sheol, that he actually died in there and was brought back to life. And so it's not so much about the plausibility of a particular sea creature being able to have pockets of oxygen or something for someone to survive, that exegetically it's a death account, and this is why Jesus then uses this in the gospel accounts for his own death on Friday, resurrection 3 days later. He says it was just like Jonah, because just as he died, Jonah did. I'm not here to defend the exegesis one way or another, but I would simply present the exegesis so as to deal with the issue of plausibility to say, well, what if Jonah died in the sea creature and was spit up and then God brought him back to life? Is that not plausible? And if they go, no, then we got to go back to the God thing, because really, I don't think you believe in God if you don't think God can take a dead thing and make it alive. What kind of God do you... let's go back. Everything that has beginning has a cause. The universe had a beginning, so the universe had a cause. And we go back to the existence of God, because what's driving the idea that God can't raise a dead thing up or God can't perform a miracle or something is a presupposition that God doesn't exist, or if he does exist, he's not omnipotent. In which case, show me evidence for believing that there is a God who exists that lacks omnipotency. What are your reasons for that? And if they're just appealing to their own intuitions, like, it just sounds crazy, like Noah's Ark. Oh, you think he got like two of every animal on that thing? Whoa. And I'm like, you realize the evidence you're giving is, whoa. that's not evidence, try that in court, Your Honor, you really believe he killed that woman? Oh. You got to appeal to, like, eyewitnesses and stuff, like cameras. Give me some evidence, not just, ooh, I don't believe that. That's just your emotions. If God exists, he can get, two giraffes to walk on an ark, for Pete's sake. That's not hard. So I just try to press into what's driving it, and try and get to the presuppositional level. We all have presuppositions. They make up our worldview. They drive the way we look at the real world. And with that, so if I'm reading Scripture and I encounter something in Scripture that causes me to go, whoa, I want to in my own heart. This is me speaking not as an apologist with a non-believer. This is me speaking to you as a brother in Christ. If you're reading Scripture and you come across something, you go, whoa, why are you going, whoa? This is a Reformed church, so, the doctrine of election makes people freak out the same way atheists freak out about Jonah, that God chose you. That's not fair. Okay, but, that's what the Bible says. Before the foundation of the world, he chose you. My Arminian friends are doing the same thing my atheist friends are doing with Jonah. That's not how we approach the Bible. We don't approach the Bible with our culture scrutinizing what it's saying. The Bible scrutinizes our culture. That's how we do it. So if you're reading a text as a Christian, I'm using the doctrine of election, for example, or I don't know, get politically incorrect, if you're reading Paul saying only guys can be pastors or something, and I don't know, you're a lady. Well, that's not fair. Okay, like, but we're talking about what Scripture says. So present an exegetical argument, at least, if you believe it's Scripture, for why that's not the case. Don't just go, I don't like that. That's what my kids do, you know. I don't like that. But what you like and what's real, right, like those don't always go together. You might not like that you got to clean your room, but you got to get it done, dude. So I don't like it doesn't mean that your room's not a mess. So I go along those lines.
Thank you. That's really helpful. Yeah, I think the more that we were able to actually draw back to that reality of there is a source of truth. There is a primary reality that exists. And I found it to be particularly helpful with these difficult questions. And there are legitimately difficult questions, which unbelievers especially will have a tough time swallowing. You know, that a Jew 2,000 years ago died, was resurrected, and that death and resurrection is what seals my eternal fate if I believe in him. That's a difficult thing to comprehend. That's a difficult thing to accept, and that in taking that in faith, we put our trust in the reality that there is a source, that there is a primary reality, and that is God. So to try to take people back there and say, can we agree on this? Can we talk about this first? Because from there, all of these other things will have to flow. If yeah. that reality doesn't exist, this conversation, it won't ever lead anywhere because you're just jumping right into the middle.
And yeah. and on that note, like for a Jewish person 2,000 years ago, look at how the apostles addressed them in the book of Acts. They quoted Jewish scripture, and they argued exegetically and intellectually, this is what the scripture says. This event in history corresponds to what the scriptures say. They didn't like emotionally manipulate them, which is where even in telling my testimony where I'm not sure at what point along the way I got saved, but definitely when I walked the aisle at the church I was telling you about, you know, but I think a lot of times when people preach the gospel, I say, cue sappy music. You know, the preacher gets up, come to Jesus, and the band starts playing all soft. You know, it's like, what is this? Like, we're like wooing people or manipulating them in a lot of these churches nowadays. And you go, like, dude, it's a message. We got reasons for believing it. Here it is. We preach Christ crucified. The Spirit draws men to himself. Look at how they preached it 2,000 years ago. They didn't cue the sappy music. They didn't use emotional rhetoric. They argued based off of eyewitness testimony. They argued off of scripture. They argued off of verifiable data. So it wasn't a checking your brains at the door. It was actually putting your thinking cap on and digging in. But I find our culture is really picky choosy with this because people on the one hand will say, how can you believe, you know, like Jesus, you know, he died and he's risen or whatever. And like, at least in my circles, I mean, these are the same people who think Tupac's walking around. So it's like you selectively will believe in all kinds of things that are supernatural. So let's get at the coherence of your worldview and how you're picking and choosing to believe that this is the case or this isn't the case. And, you know, try to scrutinize why they believe what they believe.
That's great. Thank you. Thanks. There's a lot more questions I had here. We're running out of time, but I did want to give a few minutes. If any of you guys have any questions that you wanted to ask Matt about tonight's message, about this topic, we have a few minutes to be able to answer a couple of those questions. Does anybody have a question for Matt based on tonight's message or about the topic of genuine faith?
How, when thinking about genuine faith in our lives as Christians, and we see that there are sins in our life that, you know, that it's harder for us to deal with or than others. So, you know, we're struggling with sin and you genuinely believe you're a Christian. How do we battle that without doubting our faith, without thinking, well, my faith is not genuine because I'm sinning, you know, in this area, you know, I'm not praying enough, I'm not reading enough, I'm not disciplined enough in this. I think for a lot of, you know, maybe younger believers, it causes them to doubt. So I'm not a genuine believer, so I'm just fake. So how can we properly kind of think about that and balance that in our minds?
The short answer is preach the gospel to yourself. So if I'm wrestling with my salvation because of a particular sin, then I need to come in repentance. And then I might go, well, am I really repenting, or is this like worldly sorrow and not godly sorrow? And I'm kind of caught in that hamster wheel that we can get in. That's where I begin to preach the gospel to myself. I say, I believe in the one who did not struggle over sin. I believe in the perfect one. I believe in the one who, you know, died for me. And I believe, you know, like I was saying tonight, it's not do, don't, it's done. And I start preaching to myself that I'm accepted in him. The fact of the matter is non-believers aren't worried about whether or not they're in Christ, right? Non-believers aren't wrestling with that. So if anything, it's the Spirit is bearing witness in you that you are in him, and the heaviness that you feel as a result of whatever sin in that season of life you're dealing with, or, you know, it's a part of it. I need Christ. Look at how helpless I am. Oh, thank you that you accept a wretch like me even... You know, it's you know, and you start going to certain accounts, right? Like, look at Peter. Look at how many times Peter messes up, and Jesus, you know, comes to him. Like, in the gospel accounts, just keeps coming to him. And then in the book of Acts, even, he's an ethnocentrist, won't go to Cornelius. You know, God gives him a vision, and he's like, oh, that's unclean. It's like, God just keeps pressing into him. I'm a sinner, and I have a mighty Savior who keeps pursuing me. I'm a wretch. But you know, there's therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. I'm called to examine my faith to see that I'm in him. So when people pastorally come to me with this, I go, you know, it's good that you're doing that. You should have a little bit of doubt, and you should wrestle with that, but you need to preach the gospel to your doubt so that your doubt then turns into duty and a renewed calling. You can have victory over your sin. You can. And so, you know, You're never going to be perfect under the sun. It's always going to be something. But then that's the sweetness of the gospel. He accepts me in spite of. But, you know, there's all sorts of pastoral questions I would ask in response, like, what are we dealing with? And how are you growing in it? How are you confronting it? What are you doing? Because a lot of times people think that it's just going to go away or something like that without actually doing some work on it, you know. If you want to learn how to do something, you actually have to practice it. So how are you practicing your fight against sin, accountability, et cetera, spiritual discipline, et cetera? But the short answer is preach the gospel to yourself. When I sin, and I do, I preach the gospel to myself. And I keep coming back to, I do this, but Jesus didn't, and he died for me. Isn't he good? You know, I just keep coming back to that.
Amen. Thank you.
Yeah, amen. Any other questions, you guys? Anything else for Matt? Well, all right. Matt, you were really clear tonight. You answered all questions.
I'll get all confused tomorrow. Don't worry.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. Okay, you guys.